so well understood, so rounded now, that you can essentially model any other protocol on top of HTTP. So we see, you know, old protocols like SMTP getting eliminated in favor fundamentally of HTTP. And that was a transition that's taken 15 years and will take 20 years really to fully complete. Today we're at the same early portion of the curve with a similar kind of movement, and that movement is to elastic cloud infrastructure. Now, the term cloud is being, you know, slapped on all sorts of different things. You know, if you don't know what else to say about your product, call it a cloud product and hope for the best. But what's really going on is this shift to an abstraction layer for infrastructure. When the dust settles, I think we'll see a very clear pattern emerging. And my perspective is that in 5 years' time, most people, when they're deploying new capacity, will deploy it in an elastic fashion. So compute, storage, network will essentially be treated as bulk commodities, whether that's internal to an organization or external to an organization. Now, a lot of people, you know, there's a great debate at the moment between, you know, the relative advantages of platform as a service, where essentially you write your applications in an environment which is inherently scalable, versus infrastructure as a service, where you still essentially think of it as, to a certain extent, generic raw material infrastructure that you have to shape, you know, in a virtual machine. These two, you know, have benefits. You know, each have relative benefits. To me, it's very clear that infrastructure as a service will win in the sense that everybody will do infrastructure as a service. This will be completely ubiquitous, just as everybody has HTTP in their network today, whether it's internal to the company, external to the company, between companies. You know, HTTP is the lingua franca. In the same way, standardized infrastructure as a service will be the baseline of all compute raw materials. Platform as a service will certainly thrive, I think, but it'll thrive as a service on top of the infrastructure, the elastic infrastructure that people will provide. I don't believe that any of the single provider platforms as a service, like Google App Engine and so on, will gain real traction, simply because they don't address the legacy story well enough. It's just not possible to think to start, you know, taking your legacy applications into that environment. Whereas it really is possible to start migrating legacy applications into the infrastructure as a service type environment. So to me, it's very clear that infrastructure as a service will be the common foundational layer. It's also very clear that that will be built on open source, for the simple reason that every major network infrastructure platform for the last 20 years has been essentially pioneered, led, and standardized around open source reference implementations. There will be proprietary stories in there. I'm sure, you know, Microsoft will have an infrastructure as a service product, and other vendors will too. But in order to survive, they will have to speak some sort of standardized infrastructure as a service protocol, just as they have to speak HTTP today. The leading candidate in my mind for that kind of Apache of the cloud role, the reference implementation, is OpenStack. It's not a settled question by any means, but I think the leading candidate is OpenStack, and it's that for a number of reasons. First, if you look at the underlying motivations of the people driving it, it's easy to believe that they all have an interest in a high quality, open source, level playing field infrastructure with the costs equally borne across that audience. All of the telcos and public and specialist cloud providers have a shared interest in that, in the existence of that. They also all are equally weak in the sense that if they try to diverge too much from that, they're competing with everybody else who's diverging from that. None of them has a sort of strong center of gravity. So in that world, typically, you tend to find a strong center of gravity forming. I think that's likely to form around OpenStack. There are, of course, real challenges. When a project has as much mind share as early as OpenStack does, you know, it can spin out of control because too many people want too much from it. And I think the key question there is whether they're able to maintain crisp, clean, clear leadership and focus in an environment where, you know, too many different institutions are essentially banking on it representing their particular needs. I expect and hope to see some sort of official standardization process. I think that will happen around something that looks roughly like the AWS model today. Not necessarily the exact same API, but certainly the conceptual model. Just as there are multiple implementations of HTTP, there will be multiple implementations of that standard API. And in order to gain real traction, it's going to need to be something close to the current gravity well, which truly is AWS. In terms of virtualization, I think there are two stories that really, really matter. One is KVM, which is a true virtualization story. I think the first major distro to ship it was Ubuntu. It's now fairly widely supported. And I think it will become the sort of standard virtualization platform of the open source environment. And one of the key challenges for AWS, of course, is that they predate that kind of crystal, that kind of clarity. The other platform that I think is going to be very important is something called LXC, which is a containerization effort. Now, containers look like virtual machines, but they don't have quite the same level of separation between them. So they're appropriate in environments where you're willing to trade isolation for performance. So say you are a department in a bank, and you want to think of your infrastructure like a cloud. You want to manage your financial computation infrastructure like a cloud. But you don't need, you essentially each workload trusts every other workload to a certain extent. You know, all the same people have permissions to all of those workloads. In that kind of environment, you might choose LXC because it gives you a marked additional performance. So it's lighter weight, essentially. You can run more workloads on the same physical hardware. And that trade-off of performance for isolation makes sense. So we've done a lot of work in this latest cycle, for example, on making OpenStack work with LXC so that you can use OpenStack to address a network of machines, and those machines don't all have to support the hardware virtualization primitives of KVM, and you get the extra juice, the extra kick out of the hardware that you've paid dearly for. Another key technology I think that we'll see in that universe is VMware's Cloud Foundry. Now, VMware is obviously a kingmaker to a certain extent in the virtualization game, and they face this very challenging transition into a cloud world. But Cloud Foundry is, I think, a very savvy move. Essentially, it's a generic harness for platform as a service built on top of infrastructure as a service. So it's a bridging layer between platform as a or infrastructure as a service and platform as a service. It allows you to take a language environment that you want to access like a PaaS, and it lets you, while there's still always hard work to be done, it essentially generalizes the underlying scalability issue. And so if you have, you know, a platform like Django that you're interested in, it gives you a standardized way to think about the elasticity of the underlying pieces. And if you then address the elasticity story of Django itself, you can then have Django as a platform as a service. So I think Cloud Foundry is going to be an accelerant in that world of sort of mushrooming options in the platform as a service game. You can today take Ubuntu with OpenStack, with Cloud Foundry, with any of the current supported Cloud Foundry languages. And then you have, at very low cost and with you know, very high efficiency, you have an elastic cloud infrastructure with any number of different platforms as service accessible, as well as the ability to map legacy workloads into that cloud in a very easy, very efficient manner. Efficiency is a key story, I think. So ARM is going to be a really important competitive force in the data center. Whether or not there's a huge swing towards ARM, or whether it essentially just sets the agenda for the next 5 years, you know, competitive forces will tell. But we've seen a real dramatic surge in interest in ARM in the data center, ARM on the server. Ubuntu 11.10 due out this month is the first widely released operating system that will support ARM as a first-class citizen for our server edition. And there's a new generation of ARM hardware.